did last time, Christine. If anybody else shows up, we'll maybe give them a chance to speak. So with that being said, last time, is everything working? Okay. Did you want me to wait?
Yes.
Test 1-2, 1-2.
I'm like, should I just use mine? But then, I was very nice of you.
Yes.
I might use it. I'm gonna follow you later.
Oh, is this, is real hard to read?
Yeah, and a pen. And I didn't bring my notebook.
I tried on the phone.
I wish I would have.
No, that's what I was trying to do. Yeah, we didn't have internet for a long time last week.
Oh, no.
Until Saturday.
Want a cookie?
I think the one I asked from.
Oh, okay.
I'll probably take mine to my boys.
Well, then what, take none?
Oh, there you go.
There.
One for each.
Yeah, definitely.
Otherwise, what I thought it was going to be, it'll turn into a issue.
Yeah.
Very kind of you.
Yeah.
I'll say there's a very kind woman you don't know.
Right. She'll give you cookies if you're good.
Cookie lady.
Or not good.
Yes. Your dad will report. So how was your power? Did you survive okay?
We're very lucky.
Good.
How about you?
No.
48 hours, no power.
Yeah.
And lots of branches
on my car.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's not bad.
But anything on your house?
No. You got a car, and someone said, why don't you move your car? And I said, no, it's a cedar realm. It's not.
Yeah.
I didn't think.
They drink all the time.
Do they?
Yeah.
A lesson learned.
Yeah. Windstorm.
Okay. Well,
it's been proved.
Yeah.
So, learning all kinds of lessons.
It's done now.
We didn't want to learn.
Yeah. Our driveway is kind of long, and it doesn't have any trees over it.
Okay, everybody, we're back on. The PA system isn't working in the room, so we kind of won't. You'll just have to talk a little more loudly when you speak, but it is being recorded and it is being broadcast, so at least the public has the benefit of what happens tonight. So let's see, we have one new member, Andy. Andy. So, give you a chance to introduce yourself. Everybody here last time.
Yep.
So, welcome.
Oh, thanks.
Glad to have you here.
Thanks, I appreciate it. Andy Reber, I live in Bee Cave. I'm on City Council out in Bee Cave. I've also served on Planning and Zoning. Was on Cedar Park City Council about 15 years ago. So, Friends of the Park, some other activities out there, Lakeway Rotary, that sort of thing.
And everybody kind of said what's their interest in, you know, what drew them to being on the Bond Advisory Committee.
Yeah, no, absolutely. What really interests me were some of the parks projects and some of the transportation projects. Obviously, we have a lot of challenges in Travis County right now, all over the county. Hopefully we'll be able to, put together some really good projects to work on all corners and hopefully address some of the issues that we have.
Yep, good. Well, look forward to your insight. Thank you. Is there anyone else from staff that isn't going to present that's going to be joining us that we missed last time? All right, great. So we will, I know we have someone from the county attorney's office.
I'm with Julie Joe.
Okay.
Linda Martinez. I'm the assistant county attorney.
Are you going to speak?
Not today.
Are you the one that's going to finish up? The only thing I was going to say is that.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, okay.
So one more time.
Up here.
I won't be the one speaking today. Julie Joe is, but she just stepped away. Somebody called her.
Julie Joe's going to present.
Today.
Got it.
Yes. And then moving forward, I'll be presenting in some of the other meetings.
Got it.
Yeah.
Got it. Perfect. Well, welcome.
Thank you.
When Julie gets back, we will...
Hey, John. Sorry.
Yeah.
I haven't met this group formally.
You didn't? You won't?
I wasn't here last week.
You weren't here? I forgot.
2 weeks ago.
Oh, okay. So we do have one the slightly important person.
I did watch the video, though.
Cynthia introduced herself. Oh, it's so funny that you got past that.
Yeah, unfortunately, I was not able to attend the first meeting. I'm Cynthia McDonald. I'm the County Executive for Transportation and Natural Resources, and I really wanted to just tell you how grateful we are that you guys are here to do this important work, because it sets the tone for not just us, but for the county as a whole and what direction we're going to go. So thank you for your time. Thank you for your effort. And you're going to be in for a really long, intense ride, but I think you'll find it's going to be worth it. Thank you.
Well, Cynthia Way undersold herself. So she's the head of Transportation and Natural Resources. So you know, she oversees both the public works side and the park side, and she's the one that, you know, really brought from the staff side that, you know, got us to this point, and she will be with us the whole time. So, well, glad you're back. There's Julie Jo. We have you up front to make a couple of points that I know we missed last time. And so you might just, I think it's easier to record if you sit up there. Yeah. And y'all, so this is just, hopefully, Andy, you can go back and at least watch the part that the county attorney's office presented, which are, you know, some of the, a lot of it you'll know from your previous public service as an elected official, but you know, some of the rules that govern us in this committee, and then Julie Jo is going to pass on a couple of other ones as well. So welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
Good to have you.
So in my little spiel will be really short. So thank you again for allowing me to be here to talk with you about this. But I just wanted to remind you all, you know, in your service as advisory committee members, you know, your service is strictly voluntary. You're going to be getting email addresses today, or you'll be receiving them at some point in the course of your service. We want you to recognize that, you know, when you've got your citizen hat, your regular, you know, individual hat as, you know, individuals who are non-advisory members, but when you use your county address, you know, you're carrying on sort of in some ways county business. So we want you to just be very conscientious about that and, you know, really draw a bright line between, you know, what you do using that address and then your personal addresses. And also, I want to remind you all that when you, even if you were to use your personal email addresses or social media to carry on, you know, anything to do with this committee, that information could be subject to the Public Information Act, because just because you use a different device or your personal accounts to carry on the business of the advisory committee, that is potentially subject to the Public Information Act. So if we got an open records request, we might, and you're carrying on business using your personal accounts, we might need to come to ask you to let us view those pieces of information that you share. So, and public information is anything that you create or accumulate by virtue of your service here. So just keep that in mind. If you have questions about it, just ask us. And then another question that had come up is somebody had asked about, you know, whether they might be covered by the county's insurance because of their service here. So the answer is no. You really kind of serve at your own risk, and we assume that you are comfortable with that. And if not, let us know. The county is self-insured. You are not employees of the county. You are not authorized to, you know, bind the county in any way. Your service is strictly voluntary, so the county does not provide legal representation to you. You know, I represent the county. But if legal questions come up, we may be able to address them. Does anybody have questions about that?
I bet they might. I know Rajiv brought up, you know, very understandably, like, serve on a board as a volunteer, and we go out and get DNO insurance coverage to cover us if there was anything that came from it. And, I mean, I think your answer was clear, but he was just drawing a contrast between that and our service here. And so basically, I think we're, you know, we have to, as she said, be willing to accept any risk associated with it. I think it's very low because we can't buy the county, but it's just, you know, something you need to be willing to sort of accept as part of your service here. But do you have any questions?
I'm just not sure what the risks are, not having been through the process. Could anybody from the public, you know, sue me for not having done some right things or wrong things and drag me into court for that? And what would be the role of the county if that were to happen?
I think people sue for almost anything these days. But to give you just a short, brief answer to the question is no, we generally are not going to be, if there's a lawsuit filed against you, we're generally not going to be defending you all. We will definitely challenge such a lawsuit if the county is named as a party. But, generally the answer is no, because you all serve, you know, your capacity here is strictly voluntary to make recommendations to the court. You have no authority to bind the county. And of course, recognize that, too, as you go out to the community, you know, you're making recommendations. You don't have any authority to say that the county is going to do X. You know, you can speak as to what the commissioner's court has approved, but, you know, you don't have authority to bind the county. So there is risk in serving, but you know, you all are probably familiar with, you know, just...
No, I'm not actually familiar with the risks involved. Does that mean then, since we are an advisory body, does that mean that our actions or our deliberations are not subject to any legal risk? Because these are very large dollars that we're talking about
here, and
potentially people have a lot of, you know, lot of stake here. So can you just say anything at all for somebody who's not familiar with the process as to how best to think of it from a, you know, personal risk perspective?
I would hope that the risk is quite low. Okay. I've not heard of any advisory committee members being sued. Certainly, we have no experience with that here in Travis County.
Okay.
We do have a somewhat litigious society that could potentially happen. We don't have any experience with that, and I'm not aware of any other similar advisory committees, you know, in the state of Texas that have been sued over any of their actions.
That's
so helpful. I think it's very low.
That's helpful. That's all I was looking for.
Okay.
I appreciate that.
Would government immunity attach to what we're doing here, or not necessarily?
No, you guys serve in an advisory capacity, and you're not employees of the county, so the answer is no.
Yeah.
Any questions about correspondence? I think, you know, there's probably, like, you know, there might be some risk associated with a public information request where you'd have to hand over your correspondence. So I would definitely, once we get our Travis County email addresses, you know, even if someone writes you to your personal address, a smart thing to do if it's about the bond advisory committee is to reply from your Travis County address. So that one to me is more, it doesn't create legal risk, but, you know, it creates headache if you've got to dig back through all of your personal emails and pull out anything associated with our bond advisory board. So it's difficult, but, you know, it's a good practice to always respond from that email address once we have that option. So any questions with respect to that? I mean, all of y'all have, you know, to some degree or another served in these capacities.
I had a follow-up question last week.
How about it?
I think we'd said that we are subject to the Open Meetings Act, right? This body is?
In general terms, yes, but, you know, I don't think that you guys are going to be in danger of violating any of those things, because we're just not going to really allow that to happen, because, you know, we're going to post your meetings properly and all that. So,
well, got it.
And you're not making policy, so that's the other thing.
Okay, because we had talked about, like, a message board as an option, and I was just wondering if that communication is happening outside of a publicly posted meeting, if the message board would
present
issues.
It would not, because the message board if it's created similarly to, I think, what we have for the Commissioner's Court, that is going to be, you know, open. You know, whatever you type on that message board is going to be open for anybody else to see. And just as a general rule of thumb, you know, speaking of the Public Information Act, it's just a good rule of thumb to not write anything down that you wouldn't want your grandmother or somebody else's grandmother to see. So that's the test that I use. It's like, you know, I tell my children that, I tell my clients that, do not, you know, write anything that you don't, that you'd be embarrassed by somebody that you hold dear to see. So it's just a good rule of thumb.
Very good rule of thumb. You good? Okay. Any other questions? Thank you very much, Julie Jo. We appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. All right, so the heart of the matter for tonight's committee. So Jessica is going to come speak to us. And what I might just, by way of quick introduction, to kind of, as I'm, you know, as it's getting a little clearer even for me, you know, Jessica is, her, what she's presenting on will become apparent, but essentially she's going to talk about sort of the debt capacity of the county and how that relates to, you know, how much we might recommend in the way of dollars for projects when we submit our report. So, you know, tonight we're going to hear about what's the financial capacity of the county. Y'all have gotten the project list, and we'll dig into that next time. I will maybe have an introduction if we have time tonight. And that's really talking about what's the need of the county. So we'll, you know, we'll walk, spend a lot of time on that next time around. So we'll talk about what's the financial capacity, and then we'll talk about what are the needs within the county that we're gonna look to try and address with our recommendations. And then after that, what we'll start talking about is our evaluation criteria. So how do we align the needs of the county with the financial capacity of the county? And I think that'll be a really robust conversation. And y'all were sent what we used in 2017. I think it's already gonna have some meaningful update with respect to, you know, some equity type building equity issues, building that into it as well. So I think that's kind of where we're going to, you know, how we're going to move through this, and that's how you can put this into context, what we're going to hear tonight. And then, you know, obviously once we establish our evaluation criteria, we know the needs, we know the financial capacity of the county, then we're going to dig in to all those projects and try and figure out, you know, what we recommend we move forward, because there is a lot more on there than what the county can afford. So there you go. Jessica, welcome.
Wonderful introduction, thank you. As I look around the room, I see many familiar faces and or names. So just a quick introduction. Jessica Rio, I'm the county executive for planning and budget. I grew up in Austin and went to college in Minnesota and then came running back to Texas and found a job at the county. So I've actually been here for a rather long time. My first assignment was as a planning and budget analyst for transportation and natural resources, and I went out with Charles Berg and looked at the 1997 bond election tour, I think it was, with that bond committee. So I've been through a few of these. Today, what we're going to do is first introduce Erin, and I apologize. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Erin Boffenberger. I'm one of the assistant budget directors in the planning and budget office. I, too, am from Austin, born and raised, and I've been at the county about 12 years and working with TNR 7 years or so, and also working on capital and debt stuff about that same amount of time.
Welcome, Erin.
So we're going to go through a version of a presentation that we presented to the Commissioner's Court yesterday at Commissioner's Court, and talk a little bit about background information about capital funding at the county, our debt policies, and then where we have landed with a recommendation for you to consider as you're looking through the laundry list of items that TNR has given you. It's a little daunting, I'm sure, and so we'll try to provide you a nice planning figure that you can be thinking of as you go through that list. Also wanted to note that Travis Gatlin, our budget director, wasn't able to make it tonight. But in the process between now and the summertime, if you have any questions, we're always welcome, you know, more than willing, I mean, to come back and or answer questions via email or provide additional information. So I just wanted to put that out there as well. And awesome. I love that you're not
shaking. Hey, Jessica and Aaron. Aaron, yes. Does it work for y'all if they have questions or if any of us have questions, if we ask them yes. as you're moving through
it? Of course.
Okay.
Yes, most definitely.
Great.
However you would like to ask your questions, or it's probably easier in the moment. Okay, so I'm going to start off with turning it over to Aaron. You know, one thing I did want to mention before we get started is we had a conversation with bond counsel. We do have a bond counsel at the county who guides the commissioner's court as they get ready for the legal requirements. Obviously, we also have the county attorney's office. And a couple thoughts that I want to make sure that we keep in mind as we go through the process is the timing, one. There are particular timing issues of when the court can call the election, and so we'll want to make sure that there is enough time for the court to consider your recommendations. And I think the timeline that I know has been laid out works very well for that. And there have also been some changes at the ledge of what we're required to post. And so when we start talking about the tax impact, that's luckily what we do at the county and have always traditionally done at the county is showing the impact of a bond election is very much in line with what the new requirements are. So we're in already really good shape for that. So now I will turn it over to Erin.
Sure. So what we're going to show you is a presentation we do typically annually to the commissioner's court as a part of our debt policy. We're required to annually share a debt model, giving them a 4 or 5 year forecast of our planned debt, planned projects, and how that impacts the tax rate. So we'll give you pretty much the whole thing. So we'll talk first about some of the capital funding sources the county uses, cash and debt financing. Talk a bit about some of the other planning efforts we have going on at the county around our large infrastructure and capital that's not roads and parks, and then look at the debt model scenario. So the county has an extensive portfolio of capital assets and infrastructure, some of which we drive on and visit, and then some of which are, you know, large buildings, some of our vehicles are capitalized. We use pay-as-you-go cash financing for a large portion of our investments. We call that fund the CAR account in our general fund. And then we also use certificates of obligation, voter-approved bonds, and then in limited circumstances, we have issued state highway bonds. We're proudly have been awarded a AAA credit rating continuously since 2001. Which means that we can issue debt at lower rates and have good credit in the eyes of the rating agencies, so we're proud of that. The general fund capital acquisition resources account I mentioned earlier, we generally use fund balance as the main source for that fund, and then we also have a little bit of ongoing money that we've built into that because we do have recurring capital needs. So to give you a picture of what that account looks like, over the past 10 years, it's ranged from $18.1 million in 2014 to a high this year of $146 million. That's made of $77.8 million in projects. And then we have a large reserve of $68.3 million. Most of that is spoken for in earmarks of things the court anticipates funding but hasn't yet made a decision on at this time. And then within those earmarks, we have a large earmark of $29.8 million that we are holding for any bond project shortfalls or future capital needs. If projects get stuck, we want to be able to help move them along quickly. And that has been carried forward for a few years now, starting, I believe, at around $35 million, and we've used a bit of that over time. So obviously, debt financing is an important funding method for us for our large capital projects and equipment, and it lets us distribute the tax burden over the lifetime of the debt. So as I mentioned before, voter-approved bonds is a big part of that. Certificates of obligation, we typically issue some annually, and then state highway bonds we have issued in the past in limited circumstances. We're always, as the budget office, looking for ways to minimize the debt requirements to the taxpayers. So we do refundings periodically that are much like issuing outstanding debt at a lower interest rate, like refinancing a home. And since 92, have achieved about $44 million in gross savings by using this strategy. Right now, there are limited opportunities to do this, but we are always watching the market to know when we can effectively do a refunding. So getting into some of the actual debt financing, we issue routine COs, short-term debt, five-year maturity. We can also do longer-term 20-year COs per our debt policy, but we have specific parameters we hit to do so with court approval. Usually that's real estate transactions, things where we can show that debt financing with long-term debt is cheaper or better than using cash, or basically have to present our findings to court. And then again, we don't exceed 20 years on our long-term debt. There's a shift at the legislature around our debt issuance, and one of the biggest things that hit us recently was HB 1869 in last session, which redefined debt in the tax code. And it made some changes in how you're allowed to issue debt and how you're allowed to tax for debt. So all non-voter approved debt has to either meet some very specific stringent requirements or has to be taxed out of your maintenance and operations tax rate. And at the same time, we recently had caps placed on how much we can tax for. So for Travis County, that means that we basically just won't issue COs for things that aren't in the list in the legislation. As we're now in session again and watching bills come out, we see a lot more that would further restrict what we can issue COs for. So we've historically enjoyed the ability to issue COs for things like this building and other administrative buildings, and that's been taken away and restricted. So this has made us really cautious about what we consider issuing debt for versus paying cash for, and we're kind of trying to maximize our flexibility on cash so that we can pay cash for some things that in the past we would have CO funded.
Hey, Aaron.
Yes.
Real quickly, do you envision us making recommendations on a division between COs and GOs?
No.
So we would just recommend projects, and then y'all would sort out the most appropriate means of.
I would say that you would be recommending a bond package, and you know, Aaron's this presentation again was modified from one that we gave to the court, and I think that slide, as an example, is one that's probably more relevant for the court than it is for this group, since you're talking about a voter-approved bond package. But it's good for you to understand when we look holistically at our debt and our cash and what we have available for capital, these are the types of things that we're thinking about and looking at. But I would expect that this group is going to be making a recommendation on a voter-approved bond package for the court to consider.
So that's GOs, not COs.
Yes, right.
Yep.
Correct.
Okay.
And speaking of.
So we issue our voter-approved bonds as long-term debt. In 2017, voters approved about $185 million, split almost evenly between roads and parks. And, you know, with that program, we did have the CBAC work through a list and prioritize COs for us. We're not, as I said, not looking for that this time, but that we did have another $95 million of COs that we issued alongside the cash flow for the voter-approved bonds. We kind of wanted to highlight that because the combined number is was a planned around $280 million for, you know, the roads, the parks, and the COs. So I'll show you this cash flow. We ended up issuing a little bit less in the COs. We paid for some of the projects in cash at the end. But we ended up issuing a total of $278.2 million across the Prop A, Prop B, and the Critical Safety Project COs. with this lovely cash flow.
Okay, so again, as I was just saying, we look at our debt capacity holistically, and so we don't just think about parks and roads, we think about all the capital infrastructure that the county needs and is looking at. So these slides were meant to have a conversation with court, and we've been having a conversation with the court about things other than TNR projects. There are some large projects that the court is going to need to discuss and figure out what they'd like to do next. The one at the top here of the list, the HMS Courthouse, is currently in transition. A lot of the tenants that were there are moving over to the new civil and family courts facilities. And therefore, it is a very good time for us to be thinking about how we will renovate or restore that very historic courthouse, because that is the county courthouse. Palm School has been obviously of much discussion in recent years. We have precinct offices, we have community centers that HHS has services in. Juvenile probation recently came to court and asked for some resources to refresh a plan that they had of their campus. And so these programs and projects and discussions will eventually lead to, if I've been here long enough, money. And debt capacity is one of those areas, as Aaron touched on, that we'll need to be considering if they're CO eligible, if they're voter approved bonds in the future, if they're cash, whatever it is, that mix and match. Those discussions won't occur right now, but we have to keep that in mind as we're looking at the debt model.
And so I know I'm stating the obvious on this. We obviously don't weigh in on any of these needs. They don't fall into the purview of the Bond Advisory Committee. But where we need to contemplate that is be aware that we can't take up all of the debt capacity of the county, because you've got other needs that are not even defined at this point that you need to hang on to some of your debt capacity for the sake of these other needs that you know are in the pipeline.
Exactly, and so much like you, we make recommendations. The ultimate decision makers always are the commissioner's court. What we're here to inform you of is that we are letting the court know that they really need to be thinking bigger picture with that flexibility. And so if, for example, you know, when we get to the slides that talk about debt capacity, this group decided they wanted to make a recommendation that used up all that debt capacity, then there might be a difficult conversation with Commissioner's Court where they say, whoa, didn't you hear that we need to reserve some capacity? And so that is what I'm trying to make sure that you're very keenly aware of, is that the flexibility that we're going to be talking about, we've tried to make sure that there is some future discussion that we can have with the Commissioner's Court. And I think that the numbers that you'll see on these slides allow for that and allow for you to do really good work with the really daunting list that TNR has given you. Okay, so next slide, please. Yeah. Oh, no, this one. Yeah. This is basically the same sort of thing. It's just all the planning and assessment efforts that are going on, including the work that you're doing here tonight. You're listed as the Bond Advisory Committee on this list, but there are many different assessments that are going on, many different plans that are happening. We have a strategic plan going on. There's just a lot of work going on at the county right now that, again, we've been here long enough, always ends up with money, needs, and requests. So then we go into... Oh, I'm sorry. I thought we had cut one of the slides. This slide, what I'd like to, and we can provide these slides for everybody so that you have them to go back and look at. This slide, however, what I'd really like you to hone in on is the last set of bullets there, the considerations for the 2023 bond election. Really, really urge you to have a thoughtful and honest conversation with our TNR friends about their capacity to do the work. And so I know that we're talking about a bond program. If you look historically at the last few bond programs that we had one in 2017, one in 2011, one in 2005. So if you do the math on the how long those programs are, you're looking kind of at a 5, 6, 4, you know, 5-ish year is what we've been thinking about, and as we make these recommendations. And
there needs to be an honest conversation that these programs can get done in that time frame. It's not only important for the voters, because that way, you know, you're executing as a county, you're executing what you have, what they voted on. It's also important for the debt and for the tax exempt debt. There are specific guidelines that the IRS puts out, and so we're wanting to make sure that we can have a successful program. And I would submit that the 2017 program was a very successful program. And you know, I know Atlas 14 kind of threw you for a loop, Cynthia, but I think if y'all have that conversation about what mix and match works best for staff, that'll make for an easier program down the road. So that's what I wanted to highlight there. Is this one of the ones Travis did?
So, and I would think, Jessica, that that's the type of thing, and Cynthia, that we would build into our evaluation criteria. When we start talking about evaluation criteria, those are the things we would talk about. Hey, I also forgot to tell the committee that, sadly, we lost Chris as one of our committee members. He's working on a book project that has some very tight deadlines. But Chris brought up some great points last time about what aspect, like what needs to transpire within that 5 years? Is it, you know, groundbreaking? Is it ribbon cutting? You know, what are the implications of starting a project 3 years in and finishing, you know, 6 years right out? And I saw that y'all did a presentation on where you're at with the 2017 bond package, which sort of, you know, answers some of that, but you know, I do think that is a fair question mm-hmm. as we start to evaluate projects. Yeah, go for it.
Okay, so one of the conversations that I, when Jessica's group did the presentation to court, you know, one of the things I let the court know is that not only is there a debt capacity, but there isn't a capacity for staff and our contractors to execute within a timely manner. So while, you know, we can't give you that just yet, as you work through the projects and start working through your recommendations, we'll let you know, roughly, if this is going to be a very complicated project that could span the entire length of the program, or if this is a really easy one. You know, usually land, for example, land acquisitions are lengthy negotiations, but they're much shorter in general than doing a massive construction of, say, a $26 million bridge that has 40 landowners and you got to negotiate for right away and those kinds of things. So while we can't really give you that capacity now, it really depends on how, you know, what projects you guys are looking at, and we can help fine tune what that looks like from a programmatic standpoint and a timeline. But that is going to be something that, you know, we will want to discuss with you as you move through the project list and start forming your recommendations.
Yeah, and I would envision building that formally into our evaluation criteria so that maybe you score, like, you know, this project in terms of demands on staff is a 10, and we would say, okay, you know, that one we might need to, there's another one that still does a lot of great things, the score is 2. You know, much less demand on staff.
You could, yeah. That would be something, however you guys want to develop that criteria, but certainly something for you to consider as to whether or not, you know, the timeline, the tentative timeline would be executable within the time frame. So, yes, you might have a really great project, but if it's going to take 12 years because there's just a lot of design, a lot of unknowns, you may want to reconsider that or do a portion of that. You know, we've had some design only recommendations that allow us to do better engineering work and then come back later and ask for construction dollars. So, you know, that's a possibility as well. But yes, certainly one of those things you want to consider is it shovel ready? Do we have plans, or is it adjoining a project that we've already completed and we know a fair amount of information about, you know, the topographics, whether there's utilities, whether there's floodplain, those kinds of things. Those are certainly going to be easier for us to expand upon if it's continuation of other projects or things that we've done in recent past. We are looking for regional as well, you know, whether in the benefit to the greater community as a whole. I think that's also an important thing for you all to consider. not to say that's the only projects that you guys will recommend. That's really at your discretion. But because we have so many different issues to tackle, that may be one of those things that you maybe rate higher than others. It's up to you as a committee to decide that.
But what about that question on, Chris's question? Like, what aspect of a project needs to happen within the 5 years? Is it groundbreaking, like you just need to break ground within 5 years in a project, or do you have to cut a ribbon on it within 5 years, consistent with what Jessica was saying is important, that it kind of have a five-year time frame?
You should be spent out completely.
I was going to say, from a financial perspective, mm-hmm. we want the dollars out the door within, is it 3 years? Within 3 years of when it was issued. And remember, we're going to show you a cash flow.
Of when the debt was issued.
I'm sorry?
Of when the debt was issued.
When the debt was issued. And so if the voters approve, $200 million and I'm just using that number to round up from last time, $200 million this November, we don't issue generally $200 million in March. We issue a portion of it. And then a year later, another portion. So let's just say it was 50-50-50-50 or 40-40-40, for 5 years. It's unreasonable to think that last year, that $40 million is going to be at the same stage, if it's the same type of project, as the $40 million in the first year, right? And so that's where the cash flow and TNR and making sure that they feel secure in what the cash flow is, but also what the work is. And so I applaud Cynthia for talking about also the pre-engineering work or the design work, because some of these projects, you get better estimates also if you have that work completed than if you say, I think it's this much, but you haven't done any of that pre-work to get to a number.
And I know we're gonna have a chance to talk about that a lot as we move into the projects themselves and start to develop our evaluation criteria. So I think this is important, y'all, in terms of like as we get into it. So really what it is, and I know you're gonna show a slide later on that talks about when debt is issued, even though I know it's very theoretical at this point, and you're kind of making other points, but you do make the point that obviously, we approve, let's make it up, we approve $400 million of GOs in November of this year. You might start issuing it in March, but you could issue that 400 over the course of a number of years, and then what becomes critical is 3 years from the point of whenever a given bit of debt is issued, it needs to be spent on a project. So it's not really like 5 years from November of 2023, every project needs to be completed.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And there's always good reasons where some of those targets are a little bit longer or a lot shorter, but again, theory world, that's what you need to be keeping in mind. And so really listening to the staff on what they can execute and what the timeliness is. And then once we get into a bond program, if the bond program is proposed and accepted by the voters, making sure that the cash flows are accurate and reflect what they need for any given year.
Hey, John, I have a question.
Sure, yeah. Absolutely.
This is a good time for it.
You bet.
My question is about leveraging other sources of funds against this, either the voter approved debt or the COs. So on the, 90 million in the 2017, roughly 90 for parks, 90 for roads, and 90 for a little more for critical safety improvements. But has it been a tradition of the county or thinking from the staff side of this next round of potential funding of looking for that leverage, whether it's private investment or public funds that could be available, state, local, federal?
I know that back in the day when I was a TNR analyst, I wrote up a lot of grants where I said the grant match is being covered by the bond program, by some budgeted funds that were already there. But I'll let Cynthia or someone from TNR directly answer that.
Yeah, I mean, obviously partnering with some other jurisdiction is always going to be of benefit to the county. And if we can get into timely agreements with them, absolutely, that should be something for you all to consider, whether or not there is an interested party on the other side of the project. With regard to private, public-private partnerships, we've tried that in several instances, and we've gotten into agreements with some of them. I will tell you from our experience, and staff can chime in if they want, they're not most of the time they are not on the same timeline as we are. If they're a developer, they have a much different timeline and they have much tighter because of their financial situation and their debt model than we do. And so it's very difficult in a lot of instances to come to agreement on some of the right-of-way issues and some of the roadway design issues with them, and even worse when it comes to timing that section. So they may not be developing, a portion of their project for 10 years out, but we want the whole road. And so that becomes a little bit difficult. So we would consider them if they're ready to go with the same timeline or similar timeline to what we're expecting to accomplish.
And that's a really good point, because what you don't want to do is overcomplicate it to where you really aren't able to expend timely because there's complicated negotiations going on. And I don't remember, was that 2011 or 2005? 2011 that had a lot of public privates that had that issue.
One thing to mention, the public-private partnerships, that was a system that we used in the past, and there have been issues with it, but kind of the new version of that, I guess you could say, is we have a lot of TIA mitigation funds, which are traffic impact analysis studies that have been done, and developers have had to provide mitigation funds to us. We were thinking that that might be the new way of public-private partnerships in the sense that we would leverage those TIA mitigation funds maybe supplement that with some bond funds to allow us to fix all those mitigation needs from all the development around the county. And we can get a lot more into that detail, but that's sort of the new public-private partnership approach that we would like to discuss.
So just to follow up on that, I'm not asking that this be done, I'm just asking if it exists. What was an analysis done of the leverage of the 2017 or the 2011 bonds to show what other funds showed up once the voters approved bond packages? Have y'all seen anything like that?
I don't think there's been a lot of funds that show up after the bonds have been. It's usually we've gotten into some informal agreements with jurisdictions, but generally, if the county's going to put up funding for a roadway and a developer wants to come by, they're not going to just pony up stuff after the fact. That's generally not the case. I just wanted to clarify with what David is talking about with the traffic impact analysis funds. Those are funds that we've already collected in areas that have already seen some development. So he does have funds available. So if there is a project that you're interested in and he has funds that have been dedicated to that particular area, we would love to be able to use them. It's not going out to a developer and saying, hey, will you want to partner with us, which is what we did in 2011. Mm-hmm. So this is a little bit more solidified, if you will. It is, I think, nearly $1 million. Oh, 7 to 8 million? 78 million, okay, much higher.
It's a combination of projects themselves and funds. So I'll have to get the detail breakdown.
So we'll get you that information about what where we have funds that could be spent in conjunction with potential bond projects.
Great, thank you all.
Yeah, and I think that definitely should be one of our evaluation criteria that hang on to that. And Charles, I'm sure Gary's question is indicative of the fact that he has a foundation looking to put $50 million towards parks. we look forward to you revealing who that is, Gary. Thank you.
It'll be my pleasure.
Yeah. I'm sure it would.
Great. So back to the debt model, getting into the real meat of it here. We talked a little bit about flexibility and making sure that our debt model accounted for other things other than just parks and roads. One of those is our routine short-term debt issuance. Every year, most years, we issue short-term debt for a variety of different needs at the county. We have been trying to use some cash in recent years, and Aaron touched on that earlier. But we do have a placeholder in our debt model that accounts for that routine debt issuance. And that placeholder was $24.3 million per year. Aaron recently went back and really scrubbed that and looked at the last 10-year average, and it's actually down a little bit because we have increased our usage of cash, and so it's $20.6 million. So you'll see a $21 million number. That's a placeholder for short-term debt for routine needs at the county. And then really what we'll get to is what we're recommending that you all think about. There are three options. It's really a range. I wouldn't call it options, although it shows up on the next slide as options, but there's a range of $350 to $450 million that we're hoping that you'll think about targeting for this bond election. And the way we did that, we had to come up with a criteria of how to limit or figure out what that number, that range should be. And so we'll show you that on the next slide. But the way we did that is we really looked at our debt ratios and picked the most constrained one and used, Aaron went through and did a variety of different exercises to see what we could squeeze in, big picture, in theory land, with a cash flow that is not realistic, but allows us to stay underneath all of our debt ratios within our debt policy, which is important to us because we are AAA rated and meet with the rating agencies every time we issue debt. And so that is on the next slide, the $740 million. And so, again, we think that for you, for this group, Travis looked at that last bond election, including the safety projects, put an escalator on it, and was getting between about somewhere in the $400 million range. And so, again, if you look at this $740 million, knowing that we have a lot of other needs at the county, we're targeting a recommendation of $350 to $450. And so I'll pause there because I'm sure there might be questions.
You should be much more dramatic in the way you do that big reveal of what the number is.
John kept asking, what's the number? What's the number?
Everyone in this room is like, what's the number? Yeah, so question, yeah, how about it?
So clearly we live in a very volatile interest rate environment, and wasn't that a big uncertainty in some of your projections?
So our interest rates have been increasing, and as a matter of fact, when we go through and talk about the impact on the tax rate, we'll point to that. We do issue at very low rates, and we also, one of the slides, I don't think we talked about refinancing, did we? Oh, yeah, you did.
Yeah.
We do refinance on often as well, and so oftentimes, if we're issuing in a higher rate environment, once those bonds are callable, we tend to refinance, and we have PFM as our financial advisor, and we have conversations very frequently about refinancing debt that's already on the books. For the new debt that we're modeling here, Aaron talked to PFM about our interest rate assumptions, and so she used an escalator because, of course, you know, if we knew what interest rates were going to be at, we probably wouldn't be sitting here with y'all tonight. We would be doing other things. But having said all that, this is all based on assumptions, and you know, they're the best assumptions we have once we've consulted with our financial advisor.
Is there a range that you'd like the committee to be aware of? Because that 740 million is a pretty hard number that you've come up with as the limit.
Sure.
But assuming, you know, various sensitivities, et cetera, that you've done.
I think in the time frame that you're going to be doing your work, the 350, you said 740, and I'm gonna throw 350 to 450 because that's the recommendation. The
right, 740 is what you total. Have the capacity for, and of
at
which you recommend 350 to 450
yes.
is what the committee consider as available
Correct.
For recommendation.
Right, and so within the time frame that you're working, which is between now and June, I think these numbers will likely hold.
That's helpful to not have a range to work with. To have a single number is always good.
Yeah.
The 350 to 450, does that include the projects you just had on the previous slides?
No.
Okay.
So the 350 to 450 would be for this committee to be targeting recommendations for open space, parks, roads, drainage, whatever the list that TNR provided you, which I believe totaled over, it always totals over a billion, and I always say a bazillion, but I'm sure it's more than that. But no, the capacity that we're leaving for the court for the future, because we really don't know the prioritization of the other projects. We don't have necessarily budgetary numbers on the other projects, but we do have experience and know that facilities projects tend to be very large in isolation. So the 350 to 450 is for this committee to target for considerations for your recommendations.
Okay, so we don't have to take into account the other two slides that you showed that needed to be carved out. So that's what I was really asking. So for us, expend number 350 to 450 doesn't take into account to the previous slides that you showed.
You don't need to worry about what we need to worry about.
Got it.
That's all right.
You had a question?
I have a question regarding debt that's outstanding currently.
Sure.
And kind of if there's a schedule of when that debt is going to be retired and if that factors into what we're doing here or if that's...
That is, you can make the assumption that that is all factored into this recommendation.
Okay.
She has, the debt model that we're going to show you on the next slide is not the debt model that she works with. She
sure.
has a very complex set of worksheets that are interrelated that have debt schedules for every single issuance we've ever done or have done in the past, you know, that we're still paying off. When we refinance, you have to zero it out and put the refinance. I mean, there's, so all of those assumptions, all of that information is in this recommendation.
Thank you.
Yeah, please.
I'm wondering if y'all could speak to the prior cycles of the bond amounts and the ratio of the bond that was achieved versus the amount of future debt flexibility that was left kind of in the coffers or earmarked, and if A, B, and C are all kind of within, I assume they're all within the historical ranges of the ratios that are left, and then kind of if you could give us some idea of what that ratio was. So that.
So let me make sure I understand the question.
So, sorry.
No, go ahead.
So the future debt flexibility as a percentage of what we're.
Okay, so not necessarily.
Okay.
The 20, and I'm going to skip over 2017 for a second, but the 2011, we had made a recommendation, and I recall that we had recommended to the committee and to court that there be some limited flexibility. I think it was $30 million for state pass-through financing projects, and I don't believe that that was, that recommendation was, I believe that the committee went over that amount. However, I will note that that was a $30 million issue that we were dealing with at that time, and so even though the recommendation I think from the committee was larger and maybe even the court went a little higher, I don't recall, Cynthia, we were only having to deal with $30 million.
Yeah.
I think what's different and unique in this scenario is the fact that we have not one or two but several items that are outstanding for discussion in the coming time frame that
right.
is the bond program. And so this approach is more suited to that, and so it's different than some of the recommendations we've made in prior years.
The reason I ask is I think a function of the number that we end up arriving at, we also want to make sure we're being good stewards
yeah.
for future bond cycles, but also I think what we end up selecting speaks volumes to the creditworthiness that we've worked so long to achieve from, you know, just debt service in general and making sure that we're on good financial footing, you know, as a jurisdiction. So just wanted everyone to have
definitely.
Yeah.
And that's why I keep, when people ask about this recommendation and the capacity, I keep pivoting towards TNR and saying, what can you execute? What is responsible for your staff to be able to get done in this 4 to 5 year program? Because we are a pretty healthy county financially, and we take that very seriously, and we're very proud of that. But I really think that having a responsible program that is executable is the most important thing.
Is it three or four counties that have AAA rating?
It's
seven.
It's,
I think it's eight. Okay,
yeah.
Seven,
it's
eight now.
It's eight
okay.
now.
Really healthy county.
In Texas.
In Texas.
Yeah.
In Texas.
Yeah. James, I think James makes a really important and valid point in that, like, we wouldn't be sitting in this room being able to talk about, $400 million of projects if the county had not been conservative and responsible in years going forward. And so I think that's just an incentive for us you know, to carry that legacy forward. Because I will tell you what will happen is it starts to get hard to drop projects off. What you're, there is like this natural inclination to want to do another park, to do some bike safety lanes, to do some roadway when the community start coming before us and telling us how important the projects are to them. You'll feel the pressure over time. You know, it's much easier to like want to go above than it is, you know, to hold firm to a number that's financially responsible. But you know, again, we wouldn't even be able to get to talk about you know, something of this magnitude had everyone that went before us kind of adhered to these same set of principles. And I would also say, you know, like what really is a meaningful thing is, you know, let's say we're talking about $350 to $450 million of projects. Like that is, it just sort of shows you the significance of the task in front of us and the difference that it's going to make for the people that live in Travis County. I mean, that is a meaningful bunch of parks, open space, and infrastructure that's really going to enhance the quality of life for all of our neighbors and friends. So, yeah.
And the other thing I want to point out that we'll show you on a slide at the end is there is an impact. These aren't free, right? These projects have a cost to them, and we all partake in that cost for the good of the benefit of the community over the next 20 years. For the $400 million as an example, you'll see on the last slide that for every $100 million, it's about $11 is what we're estimating right now. So that's $44 for 20 years that an individual household would be paying on their property taxes. And so that's the other thing that we weigh as we make recommendations to this committee and to the commissioner's court, and that the court weighs, because they're responsible to their taxpayers. So why don't you go to the next slide, and we'll walk
You can go back on the future debt flexibility. One, just to understand on the time of awareness, especially is that future debt flexibility based off of once the bond is approved, or does it take into account over the next 5 years and any of the previous debt that gets paid off? So could that 390, like if we say, hey, it gets voted in, 390 now is the flexibility, but over the next 2-3 years, some of the debt gets paid off, so it's no longer really 390. It comes to 400, 410. And I think that's something to understand too, because if there are those capacities where certain debt is gonna come off the books, then we know we can probably go to a higher benchmark.
So I'm going to answer it the same way I answered an earlier question that was similar to that. The question was earlier about the debt being paid off and whether that is going to impact these numbers. That is already built into these recommendations. Okay. Now, these are all assumptions that we make, interest rate assumptions, how our tax base is going to grow over the next few years. I mean, there's a lot of variables that go into our debt model, and obviously if those variables are wrong, which I can tell you right now they're wrong because they're assumptions that we make based on a lot of experience, but if I could tell you what the tax base is going to, I mean, I don't have a crystal ball, but they are very well-grounded, educated assumptions that we make based on many, many years of experience of doing this. And so the question that you had about debt being paid off is already in this, these recommendations. And that's not to say that the court might not decide to issue more or less in the future. That's really up to the commissioner's court, right? But again, we wanted to make sure we were limited by our debt ratios to come up with numbers and then make clear recommendations based on what the last bond package was, based on all of the outstanding facility infrastructure that we have that we're going to need to be discussing in the next few years, and this is where we've landed. There was a question?
Mine's more of a nature of a comment, just for the committee to thinking about that from the time of the last bond to today, the rules for county finance have changed dramatically with 86th legislature, the 2.5% new revenue, and then 87th, that was that slide we saw, and then what's going to come out of this legislature. So it's valuable to us to look at 11 and previous, but we also have to consider it's a new world. It's that they're staff is dealing with and making recommendations to us.
Yes.
All right.
And we feel it. We feel the weight of that.
Fortunately, they
world.
Won't be done by the time we are, so we, you know, let you all worry about that. Not a
Thanks. Yeah, thanks, John. Okay, so this is the debt model scenario. Like I said, it's actually a bunch of more complex interrelated worksheets, but this gives you all of the information you need to do the work that you'll be doing here. Couple things to highlight. I mentioned the $21 million for routine needs in the COs. That's on here. We also have included $58 million for short-term debt for this year, although the court has not yet made a decision to issue any number of short-term COs. However, given the storm that just happened, given the legislature, we're making sure that we position the Commissioner's Court in a position that they have the most flexibility if they so need it or desire it. And so they did pass a reimbursement resolution yesterday, so we have assumed the $58 million would get issued. Now, we did ask Aaron to look at it without the $58 million to see if that provided you a lot more flexibility. It does not. So we don't feel like anything on the short-term debt is really impacting very much. I think it was like $2 or $3 million.
$3 million.
Impacting the recommendations that we're making here tonight. With regard to voter approved bonds, that is the lighter colored line three rows down. That cash flow is crazy, and I don't believe it's realistic. However, it goes to show you that TNR, if they needed to, could really upfront a lot of a successful bond election in that first year of issuance. Which is good news. It's good to have that. Now, the reason I point that out is more than likely the cash flow that you see there is not going to be the cash flow that the county uses if there's a successful bond election. And that could impact our ratios, right? And so those ratios might be a little bit different than what we're showing you here, and that's okay. When we have conversations with the rating agencies, they know, they really want to know that we're planning carefully, that we're looking at this stuff with thoughtful and precise assumptions, which we are, and then they understand that if the cash flows need to meet a more natural cash flow for the sake of the projects, that it's okay if, for example, we go to 801 and come right back down. I used to have a boss back in the day that used to talk about white lines. So you're driving down a road and you have white lines that are dashed or that are solid. It's okay if you go over the dashed ones momentarily, but you got to come right back into your lane and keep driving. You don't want to stay out of your lane. And so that's what we mean when we look at these ratios down below, and I tell you that the cash flow, if the cash flow changes and it means that at some point in the future when you're not even on the bond committee anymore, you see that we went to 801 and came right back down, that's okay. Future debt capacity is listed on here, also a fake quote-unquote cash flow that we used to make sure that we could get to that 800 net bonded debt per capita, which is the ratio that we used as our limiting factor. I'm going to let Aaron talk a little bit about our ratios here in a bit so that you'll have this information in the PowerPoint. We can also send you the debt policy if that would be helpful. That has all the information on the ratios. And I can tell you that the most important one is the net bonded debt per taxable value. We are a pretty rich community, property-rich community, and so we do pretty well there. Our secondary ratios, which are not listed here, are ones that we tend to keep an eye on as well because they include our overlapping debt. We are not the only taxing entity that has bond elections. We are not the only taxing entity that collects property taxes, and so obviously we want to make sure that our constituents' needs are being met, but we also want to be good partners and make sure that we're accounting for that. Go ahead, Wendy.
Do we know of any bond elections being planned this year or at the state?
That's a good question.
That is a good question, and I'm trying to remember. There was the AISD one last year, because I go to the joint subcommittee, but I don't recall if there's one being planned for this year. Do you know?
No, I don't.
Yeah, I was asking Cynthia. I was looking right at you, but I was asking Cynthia.
No, I don't actually, but I know Pflugerville ISD just had one. So,
And AISD just had one. So the school districts have the big ones.
Them, what they've done is going to impact ACC. Going forward, all the communities that they right. touch. So.
Right.
Yeah, those are the main three, ACC, AISD. Mm-hmm. City of Manor is going to be doing one this year.
City of Manor, okay.
And that, you know, I will say that there was some discussion about that when we, you know, when the county talked about moving forward with 2023, was laying stake to November of 2023 before anybody else did, you know, somewhat by design. But there's also, you know, a very loose understanding between the city of Austin and Travis County that, you know, they try not to go on the same years and alternate because those are big ones, you know, along with the ones that Dr. Wallace mentioned. Oh, they do? Okay. You know, none of those would be so big that I don't think, you know, it would be a real impediment to people voting yes for Travis County.
I would not make that assumption.
Yeah.
I honestly would not. Again, say, for example, City of Manor, even though the actual taxes compared to Austin, people in Austin pay more, we have a higher rate. And that has a different skew in people's mindset when you look at the rate percentage versus actually what they pay. Yeah. So, I mean, really, especially when it comes to the communication piece, those things will have to be highlighted so people don't say, I'm paying what percentage?
Yeah.
So.
And I will say, you know, all that communication will be part of the, you know, the campaign to vote yes. That won't be, you know, we won't be doing that. But that clearly, you know, the campaign will take that into consideration. Yes.
So just to, you know, I want to make a comment that just to validate how I am understanding this, we are talking about other bond elections, you know, and other considerations, et cetera. But what I'm hearing from budget and planning office is that we don't have to worry about all that. For the purpose of this committee, we are looking at a list of projects and we are given 350 to 450 million. And what else is happening as to whether that 350 to 450 is accurate or not, or what might influence it, that's not within the scope of the committee.
Yeah.
We should not second guess the expertise and the knowledge base that goes into that number.
Absolutely, you're correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and there will be a lot of that kind of, a lot of it's already gone on, again, kind of laying stake to November of 2023 in the Travis County going out in front, but that's not within our purview. We've got our numbers that we're working within, and then, you know, a campaign that I hope you all will take part in, you know, will work to get the community to vote yes, and then you start to talk about those things, you know, how do you pitch it to Maynard, you know, realizing that they have a high rate, even if it may be a lower number, and you do all that, but absolutely what you said is correct.
Okay. And I have come from a finance background, so while finance is in the room, I just have one more question. In this list of projects that we will be looking at, have you computed an NPV or any financial metric that would allow us to understand the cash flows that each project represents, not the debt cash flows?
On the TNR projects?
Yes.
No, we have not.
And that is very difficult to do, or, you know, how else would we make a financial cost, net cost determination? Because some projects will have more cost in the future versus now. Some will start only later. Is that a common practice?
We can work with TNR and see if there's, you know,
okay,
assistance that we can provide there. I don't think we've done that in the past, any kind of payback analysis or rate of, you know, ROI kind of thing.
Well, there won't be any ROI because they're not revenue generating, but there would be an NPV of the cost of the project that allows us to compare apples and oranges across the
projects. So like the inflationary aspects of construction going up over time?
That's yet another thing, you're right. Yeah, yeah, but just the discounting.
I'm sorry, I wasn't clear on what the question was.
So he's asking if we've done any kind of financial analysis to prioritize the projects within your list of your projects. And I'm saying I don't think we've ever done that.
Overall? Oh, no. Yeah, planning and budget doesn't generally do any kind of prioritization. This group will, though, overall. We have in the past assisted. From a staff standpoint, we can tell you what we think are higher priorities. based on some different factors that you'll hear from our staff. But ultimately, you know, you're going to be crossing different types of projects, you know, comparing a park to a, you know, roadway expansion and that kind of thing. And so that level of prioritization will be ultimately up to this committee.
Yeah, Rajiv, yeah. Hang on to that.
Okay.
When we get to our evaluation criteria,
that's
I think
what
that's
I was dealing with that, yeah.
You know, a thoughtful approach to this. Anything else? Because I just want to make sure we move, get through it all, but no,
yeah,
please.
I have one question.
Again, our office doesn't really, once it gets into the project list.
I would say
that is
evaluation. Yeah, those are more project-related criteria. Our planning group, we have a short-range and a long-range planning group, and our long-range planning group, along with our public works folks and our parks folks, actually sit on various committees and groups. We're part of CAMPO, the Capital Area Metropolitan Planning Group. Organization, we have to be part of that, and that is a regional planning group. So yes, we're well aware of what the projects are within the other counties, other cities. Everybody has to submit their list of projects. We also, I think you might have seen it earlier, have a transportation blueprint, which was approved by the court, and that is our growth plan for our transportation network. We have a land water transportation plan and a parks master plan that also looks at long range goals for our open space and parks and how conservation areas that we're very interested in for contiguous to park space to existing parks that could be whether it could be other jurisdictions as well. And we do multi-jurisdictional projects all the time. So yeah, if there is something that you know about that you don't see or want to tap our brains as to whether we're aware of it, please bring it to our attention. We can certainly consider that.
Aaron's dying to talk about ratios.
we were just saying that we were probably going to skip them if it's in the background. I want to be respectful of your time. Happy to go over them if you want us to.
Appreciate that. I think it's right. I mean, one is y'all are so freakishly below your benchmark ratios that it's almost.
We're healthy.
Yeah, extremely healthy. Even if we do 350 to 450, if I was a commissioner, I'd be saying, why are we so far below those ratios? But
because you'll get to the last slide and you'll see the impact to the average homestead.
Okay, and that's where I was, that was exactly where I was gonna go. So there is one thing that you said, you know, really what you kind of used as your constraint, your overarching constraint to create, you know, the, what's the overall number, 740 is $800.
Per capita.
Can you walk us through what that means and how you pick that? And then we'll move, it's super important to move to what does it mean to, the average or median home?
Sure. So it's a pretty short answer, or the short answer is it's in our debt policy. And so we want to make sure we're adhering to our debt policy. Our debt policy contains that. And so that number is the one that we used as the limiting factor. Net bonded debt per capita, again, I think it plays a more important role when you look at the community as a whole and you start talking about some of our secondary ratios, which are the overlapping debt ratios. We've done some looking at what other counties have as their net bonded debt per capita, and I think we said that the average in 2020 was like 700 or a little bit less than 700. We looked at the city of Austin's recently just to see what they were at. They were at 12 or they're at 16
they're
now.
At 1600 now. They were at 12 a few years ago.
But again, I think it's important to consider the community as a whole.
Definitely.
And I don't think that when a voter is considering a bond prospect that they're thinking debt per capita. They're going to be thinking what that last page is telling you. And so maybe we could flip to that and then come back, because
sure.
I do think that's important for this group to see and digest, which is the estimated increase on the average taxable homestead is about $11 per 100 million is what we estimate. And that's come down over recent years. I can tell you that, was it 2017 or 20, somewhere in the...
It was 12 last year, and I think 13...
And it was 14, because I was thinking about the civil courthouse. Yeah. That discussion was about 14. So as properties increase in value, and as we have more properties in this area, our tax base grew 22%, y'all, last year. 22%. It's crazy, right? And so that tax base is able to absorb additional debt. And so this number, thankfully, has been driven down somewhat over recent years. But the average taxable homestead in Travis County for 2023 fiscal year is $427,000. And that's taxable, so that already includes our 20% homestead exemption and any other exemptions on a macro level. And therefore, for per 100 million, it's about $11. And so if you, again, targeting 400 million, it would be about $44, which I think is in line with, I'm trying to think what it was last time. What we can go back and look at what we told voters in 2017. The other thing that we did in 2017 that I wanted to make sure you knew is we had a calculator on our website. If the committee would like for us to do that,
yes.
I'm sure Travis would be more than willing to do that so that individuals can plug in their own information and have
just
that information available to them. Yeah.
No reason not to. I have a weird question. Since you're bringing up and highlighting about the medium for a homestead and so forth, and I know the county operates the appraisal district and so forth, is there anything that shows across the different cities, as well as the ETJs, if anybody, across those different areas, where there may have been areas of burden trying to just be able to pay the taxes on the house. Because, we know this, whether it's Westlake or compared to another area, right, some areas may have a harder time just paying the homestead and the taxes on the house. And so just $11 more, which for some means nothing, they spend it on whatever, means something totally different from another population. So across the county, what does that look like from the housing piece itself? Because we already know it went up 40% across the board in Travis County for every house. And they're worried about that. And there's nothing that's really bringing that cost of the house down outside of the 10% increase year over year. That's gonna happen regardless.
So, One thing to before I try to even delve into the complications of that question, which I appreciate the question, and I think it's an important one to think about. Travis Central Appraisal District is not connected to Travis County in any way. So I just want everybody to know that the Travis Central Appraisal District is independent, and they appraise that their duty is to appraise, and so they're very separate from the taxing entities. With regards to the question of do we have information across the county, I am certain that we could have a discussion outside of this meeting and try to see if we could get some information for you. I would say that what ends up happening once the appraisal district appraises all the properties, et cetera, is this last year as an example, our average taxable homestead property tax bill for the mythical average taxable homestead went down by $18. But, as you so noted, there was a 10% cap on homesteads, right? And so that what that really means is that some of that burden was shifted to renters, shifted to commercial properties, right? And so this housing market that we're experiencing right now is not as hot as it was a year ago. Some of those shifts may be shifting back. And why do I say that? I say that because we're already in the FY 2024 budget process in our office. We're already working on our guidelines for the next year's budget. And part of that work is looking at what we think or anticipate taxes could be next year. And so we anticipate a heavier tax burden next year than the $18, obviously, that it went down. I don't know about you, but when I got my tax bill last year, I was rather pleased. It did not go up, and I think that was the first time in a very long time that my tax bill had not gone up. I don't think those are going to be the same circumstances this year. And so that is something to be mindful as you're planning for a bond election where you're asking individuals to have a higher burden. So I know that doesn't answer your question, but it just made me think about some of the other broader conversations that are happening in the background as well. But I'm happy to have a discussion with you on if we can get to something that satisfies what you're looking for. And I'm not sure if we can, but we can certainly try.
And I would, it's a great point in terms of how mindful we need to be of, spending constituents' money. So if we, let's just pick the middle number, $400 million, if we recommend $400 million of projects, we're talking about $44 per year for, the average home, $36 for the median home price. And, everyone should know we don't take that lightly. It's much harder for some people to pay that than for others. And I know, everyone on staff and at the court level feels the same way. So, for the sake of the public, obviously we take that very seriously. But also, we have the benefit of knowing that, the recommendation of us, the range of 350 to 450, all of that consideration has gone into it from, Jessica and all of the Travis County staff and the commissioner's court, taking a very conservative approach to what they do with, the public money in the meantime. So, and then hopefully what we will feel good about is that what we recommend, we feel strongly that it's worth $44 a year for the average homeowner. All right.
And with the disclaimer that these will be refreshed this summer if with new numbers from this year. So hopefully, I think it'll stay the same. It could vary a little bit. Sorry.
Yeah, please. We serve together on the TCAD Board of Directors, and so any information that we can provide to the body that will suffice to answer that question, I'm more than happy to run through our channels to get that information out to the board as well.
Awesome. Great resource, for sure. I'm sure we'll take you up on that. Okay.
That's it.
Any more?
Yes, we can make sure we send this and the debt policy.
Perfect. Yep. Okay. No more questions? Thank you all so much, Aaron and Jessica. Great presentation. It's so nice to have the universe that we get to work in, and especially to know it's so meaningful. So, all right. Got a few other matters of business. I think next is electing a vice chair, which I think is important. So here, open to suggestions, but let me just for the sake of moving this forward, what I was going to propose is everyone that's interested, just make it known, and why don't we give you a couple of minutes to just say why you'd like to fill that role. Hopefully there are some folks that are interested. And then what we'll do is do a blind ballot. So everybody can just write down who they vote for. If we have more than two, we may have to go to a runoff if someone doesn't get a majority. If we only have one, then it's easy, right? Congratulations. If we have two, we'll just collect it, see who got the most votes, and that'll be our vice chair. Hopefully it won't take too long. So, does that process work for everybody? Okay, cool. So, all right.
I just had a question about the vice chair. Does the attendance, is there a guidance on how many meetings does the vice chair need to attend?
I know no different than the guidance that we have for all committee members. The role would be to fill in if the chair's absent. I don't think too much will be involved beyond that, but we can see how it evolves. I don't think any requirement other than, what's already in the bylaws. So, anybody interested, raise your hand. if you've got an interest in being vice chair. Okay, three of us, all right, great. Thank you all for your willingness to play that role. That's great. So why don't, we have pads of paper. Why don't you just write down on a piece of paper. Oh, sorry, you know what? No, your take your time.
I was looking over here and I didn't see
wondering who it was. It was Amy.
Amy, okay.
Jennifer and Rajiv. Why don't y'all take, why don't we just start with you, Amy? You know, take a minute or two and, make a big campaign speech. But let me know why you're interested.
Sure. I am enjoying serving on this board. I've served as a city council member for 6 years and rolling with. I'm not serving there right now. But I'm really enjoying serving in other spaces as an appointee. I really enjoy the public comment process of hearing public comment and would enjoy leading meetings to make sure that the public has an opportunity to speak. And then also, I think John has done a great job of laying out the goals and the timeline for this body and would support making sure that we stay on time on things and get to that June 6th recommendation deadline.
Yeah, thanks. I kind of echo a lot of Amy's. I enjoy public service. I serve on the Environmental Commission. I'm the secretary for the Environmental Commission and for the city, and kind of the taskmaster to keep us on time and on task and on focus. For that, I've served as a vice chair for the Downtown Commission as well. And I would love to serve in this capacity for this group.
All right, thank you very much. Rajiv.
Yeah, I enjoy public service, and that's the main reason I'm here as well. I serve on a board of directors. That's my second board service that I've done in the last 10 years or so. Currently, I'm the treasurer of a nonprofit. And in terms of work on the committee, I think the few things that I thought of on why should I be the vice chair, one is being unbiased in terms of geography. I don't come from any particular precinct representing anything like else. I also don't have any biases in terms of other experiences with the government or any other aspect of the work that we do here. I have some strategic planning experience in the private sector as well, besides nonprofit. I have some cross-functional experience, which helps me look at different perspectives from marketing, finance, strategy, et cetera. Last of all, I have some, half of my professional life has been spent as an engineer. So I hope that will help me relate better to some of the engineering and technical aspects as we work through the project list. So those are many of the reasons that I actually chose to serve on this bond committee, and those are the reasons I raised my hand. The only reason not to have me is I haven't served on a bond committee before, which is why I wouldn't have put my name forward, but then I discovered in the last meeting that none of us have, exception of John. So I discounted that fact as I raised my hand.
Thank you, Rajiv, and it sounds like Dr. Wallace may be a latecomer.
Talking about the equity and the representation that all of us are presenting across the board, and especially coming from the eastern side of Travis County, we need to have representation at the top leadership positions of the whole county, east and the west. And I believe that's a huge statement, especially when we start going into the east side and being able to say, East was a part of the representation. East was part of the leadership role here in coming and creating this bond package as a team. And that everything that's being presented in this package is supporting both the East and the West of Travis County. That's huge. I don't know what y'all know about just the East and the West divide, but it's real, it's live, and it will come back, especially with all this taxing that's going on that we talked about. We need to be able to show on documents, on paperwork, that East and West are working together in these decisions. There's not that many black and brown in this room. Let that be known. We need to be able to show to the community, the ones that are voting, that we are being representative of them.
Thank you. All right, everybody. We've heard from our four candidates. Appreciate, again, y'all's willingness to serve in that capacity. So just write down your third candidate. Cynthia will collect our whatever you want. Just as long as what you write is legible.
I can't promise you that.
Yeah.
Bad handwriting. I always got to let the wife write.
You should have been a doctor.
Yeah, it is a thick paper. Y'all got some good binders,
but
huh?
It's nice, because the pen doesn't bleed through.
They spent the good money.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Oh yeah, oh, that's probably smart. You have extras. I sit next to you.
It's dunk it gold. Dunk it gold. Yeah, the pen is really.
I love those.
Thanks.
Yeah, we don't ever get fed at environmental.
Well, it's on your no.
So the good news is everybody got more than one vote. So now the top two are Jennifer and Larry. So if y'all will all now just do a second round between Jennifer and Larry, and we'll then have our winner. There's a couple still missing, so I'll tell them the same thing when they get back.
Yeah, but like the South, like all that stuff that's going on with like the Statesman property and stuff, that's not what we're missing.
As is Larry, Dr. Wallace.
That was a hot issue. That was like, yeah. It's like, do we put that in there? I was trying to get it like to encompass it, so that the same rules apply.
We're gonna give it just a minute or two for two to get back.
So, it has its own board now.
All right. So the good news was everybody got more than one vote, and the double good news is there's now a runoff between Jennifer and yourself. So, cast your vote.
You're the last voter. You're the last voter.
Nope, still got James.
Two more votes. Unless you don't want to vote, but I would assume
you. Write your name down real quick.
And after this, we'll have some hand wrestling. Is that arm wrestling?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Well, that would have been another way to resolve it.
Jennifer and Larry waiting on you.
So You're the last vote to be cast.
Your extra piece of paper came in handy.
Wait, who are the options then?
Jennifer.
Come back.
Talk.
I mean, it says 20 minutes.
Yeah, it is. Well, like I couldn't see it. I didn't, because we're not on video.
I didn't know if I was looking over there. I didn't know.
Well, I was looking at Rita. Jeez, I was like, you said there's coming straight and speed.
I live southeast.
Okay.
So,
thank you. Thank you all for putting your name in.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jennifer. So, great. All right. Some questions came up last time about the process for taking public comments and video attendance. And Cynthia, you might want to, I don't know if you've or Sydney, who might have worked with some of the technical staff, but I know I got some input from them. And you know, the essence of it was, and if y'all have further questions, I think they're primarily technical issues, but I think also a little bit of other issues with respect to at least committee members doing it remotely. So, but the essence was, it's too complicated for them in this room to do video comments, both for us and to feed in committee members. And then with respect to committee members, I will also say that I think staff and I, you know, at least me, also thought that the dynamic of having all of us in the room together, and especially as we really start digging into the projects, that there's a lot of value of us being here. If, you know, all of us, I suspect, over the course of this long time that we'll be working on this together, will be forced to miss some meetings. You know, fortunately, we have the benefit to be able to go back and watch it. So, you know, if you're willing to dedicate 2 hours of your time, you can always get caught up. But I'm happy to let the technical folks speak to it if y'all have any more detailed questions about that, or if I've misstated anything, please, you know, weigh in.
No, you are correct. So in this room, we can't do the video conferencing in for the community members and for the committee members. The only room we can do that is the commissioner's courtroom, which is over there. So at the point where last time in 2017, we did do that on a number of occasions, very limited, when there was a pivotal vote that people wanted to make sure they were represented, then we moved over to that space, and that's the only one that has that video conferencing capability. So we would prefer to limit it to those, you know, extreme situations where someone needs to be represented and they can't physically be present to vote. On a general basis, that won't necessarily work for us. The other thing we did figure out is that taking public comment like we do for the commissioner's courtroom is also problematic, just because that's another vendor that does that. But we do have lots of other opportunities for the public to participate if they're not able to make it to the meetings. We do have the website. It has an email address. It has. We have the ability for them to do written communication. They can also call us, and we will, you know, make notes, or they can leave a voicemail to give us their feedback. There's lots of opportunities other than coming to the meetings where we would allow for that to happen. That also allows you guys to have time to think about those comments and thoughtfully respond to them rather than just react as well.
And also, very importantly, obviously, we're going to have a number of meetings out and around mm-hmm. Travis County. So we'll, you know, that'll open it up, make it much easier on folks. It'll be in the evening, and it'll be at places that are easily accessible. So
I do have a question. Are we permitted to respond to the comments? Because I know usually in the open meetings that we're not able, or the dais usually is not able to respond to comments.
Good question.
Yeah, good question. You're generally not allowed to comment back if it's not on your agenda. So. Because you're not supposed to deliberate on anything that's not on your agenda, technically. So, so they can speak on anything, the committee can set parameters around, you know, the time limits, just not about the content, but the general rule is you can't talk back with them because you're
questions
not supposed to deliberate.
Of speakers, can we ask them questions?
You could maybe ask questions for clarification, but you can also talk about, you know, just very generally about, you know, having that agendized for another meeting.
Okay.
But so you do have some parameters, but we have to be careful about not, you know, about y'all not deliberating.
Okay.
And you also don't want to, you know, have super long meetings where you don't get to your other business. And generally, you're going to have your public comment period at the beginning. So. You just want to be mindful about that.
You can rest assured we are. We all want out of here by 8.
So John, I would like to also make a comment about deliberating. Because you're going to be doing this as an ongoing process and there's so many different interests that need to be represented, I think it would be best to do it collectively and at the committee's discretion. So you put together an agenda item, you talk about these. So decisions and comments and deliberations are not made with a single speaker who happens to be here that night. And, you know, you have a lot more to consider than just the one individual or group that happens to be there that evening.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Point well taken.
And then, John, I did have one follow-up as well on the message board. So
my next question.
Yeah, I anticipated as such. So we are able to do a message board. As Julie talked about, there is one for Commissioner's Court. It would be on the CBAC website for the community to be able to post to that and for you guys to be able to give your deliberations or your comments on there as well. We will also be setting up a Teams channel because that's what the county uses, Microsoft Teams. You're getting your, you'll be okay. We're getting your, we have your Travis County email addresses, so we'll be working on that, getting those to you by tomorrow, or the end of this week. What we will need is just, you know, some more information related to our process for two-factor authentication. And so that's what's required for you to access the email, but you guys will be getting that. And when we do that, then we'll be able to set up the form for you to use the public form as well. So just so that you know, that's where we are on those technical questions you asked us about last time.
Great.
John, he has a question.
Yeah, you bet.
The information in our packet, specifically the bond projects list, are these public or are they just for the committee? Do we?
No, I think they're public. They posted them.
Yes, we? Yeah.
Okay.
So we will be posting everything on the website as well, so the public is for full transparency. But it'll also be in the Teams allows us to set up a OneDrive for the committee, so you won't have to necessarily keep up with the paper. You will have those electronic files in there as well, using your Travis County email address.
Okay.
And then
well,
I think you had a question.
I did.
Yes.
Thanks. There was a staff member who mentioned revised bios to send them to her, but I'm blanking on
Janet. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's the reason you didn't get them tonight. We're still waiting on a few of those. So as soon as we get those revised bios, then we'll be able to produce that for you. And that will also be public and posted as well.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Janet Coles. Did you get her name?
Yeah. I may not have responded. Mine looks great, Janet, by the way. There's my response. Oops.
I'm still missing a few, so I'll be creating if you guys don't submit.
Yep, y'all, if you want to change it, speak now or forever live with what Janet had to say about it.
I think y'all heard me.
Hey, so one thing we'd also talk about, and this relates to the message board, is the chance to add agenda items. And what I thought, instead of we'd kind of talk about having like a running agenda item to take up other agenda items, everybody should feel free if they've got something important that's not coming up, even though, you know, our scope of work is fairly limited. We're not like a commissioner's court or a city council where we have a wide universe of issues that we're dealing with. But there could very well be something that y'all want to add. What I was going to propose is that we use the message board to do that instead of, you know, just so we can get through our meetings in a timely manner. If y'all have something, put it on there. I can't fathom that there's anything that we, you know, wouldn't take up. But so if that works for y'all, that's what I was going to propose. Okay.
John?
Yeah, no, please.
On that, wouldn't there also be like a 3-day Open Meetings Act notice in effect as well? Just those postings would need to occur 3 days before the meeting begins, just so we're all cognizant.
Yeah, no, that's
that
right.
As well.
So if you had something that was super timely, make sure, because we have to post. Good point, yeah. James. 3 days in advance, so we've got to post the agenda. So what we're going to, what we're going to wind up doing is posting the agenda of Friday afternoon. So it needs to be, you know, the Friday before that meeting that you want it taken up, if it ever comes up. So, yep, good point. And yeah, Andy, you know, obviously we want the project list out in the world so that the communities that are going to be impacted by the projects we're contemplating beyond the county at large can, you know, gather up their thoughts, turn out when we have our, you know, meetings out in the community. I mean, that's a huge part of what we're going to do. So yeah, I'm, you know, hope they start looking at it.
Real quick question. Has this gone out to the local municipalities for their feedback on this? So we're making sure we're taking some of their thoughts into account as well.
We typically don't send that to the municipalities. These are projects within our jurisdiction. We have, from a planning effort, you know, our folks are always talking to the cities, and so we're aware of the ones that they're particularly interested in. So for example, I meet on a quarterly basis with the city of Pflugerville, one of their assistant city managers, and they are well aware. They've already been talking to our planning group and have made known what kinds of projects they would like to see and partner with us on. Mm-hmm. But these are really our sections. It could be that it is a joint project because where the city limits ends, we'll pick up a project into the county. So we don't necessarily send them out because this is really a working list. And I mean, this is a universe of what could potentially happen. We usually find out from them what they're interested in and in the discussions with our planning staff.
Okay.
And they're probably already on this list. I mean, if we've had discussions with them, they're on the list.
Yeah, I was just wondering if they may have their list of what they recommend would be a priority for the county to focus on, which may create greater, as you said, right? One project may create a greater opportunity or access or relief than another one. And being able to have that knowledge of that would be probably impactful to make sure we're selecting projects that are going to have a multi-impact versus just a singular impact for them in their area.
Yeah, when
I was just going to say they would be notified during. They would be notified, I would think, during the process of sending out notification of public meetings. So they wouldn't, you know, they would be part of the whole process, not necessarily special stakeholders, but okay. They would be invited and engaged, yes?
I'm sorry?
Yeah, so she said they were invited and engaged.
Oh,
it's part of the public, review process.
Yeah, and I'm sorry I got confused there because Wendy used to be so I wasn't sure what to do with the mic.
And we all have our own networks, obviously, that, you know, I hope you're talking to your networks of people to engage them in this process, you know, so we have the benefit of their input as we move forward. Any other questions or comments about the process moving forward? And it'll be nice, you know, we're eventually going to have all this behind us and we're just going to dig into projects. So speaking of projects, I don't know, Cynthia or David, you know, we sent out the list last time and it's kind of arranged in a certain way. And I thought it might, we've got 5 minutes left, that maybe if we could just take the last 5 minutes and if you could just tell us how to read this project list, you know, and again, we're going to spend more time on this than any of y'all want to, but, you know, I know people are already starting to look at it, and maybe if you can just very quickly kind of a 5-minute version of how to read what the way you've categorize things.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a huge list. And by the way, my name is David Greer. I'm the Public Works Director, and I'll be up here a lot doing a lot of presentations along with my Assistant Public Works Director, John Rubin. But this list, it is very comprehensive. What we have done is we've broken it up, and the first page is all the parks projects.
The what projects?
All the parks. Parks-related, open space, conservation easements, things like that. We typically separate parks and roadways for different propositions. And we have highlighted in green the higher priority projects that the staff would like to recommend, just as a starting point. So we've done that. Now, the parks is pretty straightforward. There's a lot of emphasis on open space and conservation easements. That's sort of the, I guess, the general thought about this program is to get ahead of on a lot of projects that involve right-of-way or property acquisition, to try and get ahead of development before they start snatching up all these properties. The parks projects are the first page. The second page and the third and fourth are all the roadway projects, drainage, pedestrian-wise, things like that. We have, again, highlighted the prioritized projects that the staff would like to recommend as higher priority. One thing you'll notice is there is a previous priority ranking as like the third column from the left. Those rankings were from that matrix that we used last time, the 2017 bond program. These were the rankings from that previous 2017 bond matrix that we used. Anything that you see that says new in that column has been added since the last bond program. So essentially, there are still a lot of projects from the last bond program that were not selected that have the numbers on them. And anything that says new has been added, and a little more fresh, I guess you could say. We will be reaching out to, well, we've been collecting this list. It's been a live list. We've been adding to it. And we have the actual contact information of the actual residents or citizens who requested these projects. We'll be reaching out to them to let them know that we have started the bond process, and you're welcome to come speak to these projects. A lot of people are very interested in their specific projects. And so we told them when we made this list over the last 5 years that when it comes time to start this process again, we will be reaching out to them, and we will be doing that here pretty soon. We do have estimates on these. These are very rough estimates on some of them. Some of them we don't even have estimates yet. As we get more into these projects and get more input from you, we can delve deeper into some of these estimates. Something to think about also is when we look at these estimates, any projects that are over $5 million in value for construction, we would like to do what's called a preliminary engineering report, which is an additional fund that goes to this, but helps us find I guess, obstacles, issues that we need to worry about, right-of-way issues, drainage issues, also utilities, right-of-way needs, things like that. So we are proposing that if we pick a project that's over $5 million in construction cost, that we add supplemental costs for that preliminary engineering report to help us get a better scope and better estimate and things like that before we go full into design and construction. I have the roadways. I guess I have these projects separated into different categories. We have roadway capacity. We have safety projects, bicycle safety projects, and pedestrian projects, things like that. And then we also have, on the last page, we have a couple of projects that we call substandard road projects, which are roads that we do not maintain right now. And then if we want to take on these projects, they would be projects that would be a little different than most, because these are projects that were never accepted into our system, but some of the commissioners are really wanting us to put these on here to help communities that are on roadways that are not maintained, and then we can help them get to the point where they would be in accordance with our standards and we can accept them. That's what the substandard road projects are on the very last page. I'm blowing through this as quick as I can. I have highlighted in green the totals, the running totals for all the highlighted green projects, which is about $424 million. And then the overall list, if you want to shock people, you can say the overall list has $2.6 billion worth of proposed projects on it. So there are a lot of projects on here, but we want to make sure we showed all of these because we want to have some transparency to these projects. We do have people out there that recommended a lot of these projects, and they're going to be interested in these. And so we've kept all these smaller projects in there. One thing I want to mention also is the previous bond, we had a lot of emphasis on a lot of small projects. We had a lot of flooding in 2013 and 2015. We had a lot of neighborhoods that were, they couldn't get out of the neighborhoods, things like that. And so we had a lot of drainage projects, a lot of small drainage projects, a lot of small safety projects. We had over 58 projects in the last bond referendum. This time we're proposing to actually look at more regional arterial type roadway projects as opposed to 60 small projects. We're hoping to have some larger regional projects to help the community because there's been so much growth in the county over the last 5 years that what we're seeing is we need some arterial capacity east, west, north, north, south. And so that's why we're really proposing and trying to emphasize on some more of those larger regional projects. And that's why most of those are highlighted in these projects. We're also looking at coordinating a lot with TxDOT. TxDOT's putting in a lot of projects over the next several years, and the county is responsible for right-of-way. Now, if it's on a new alignment, the county has to pay 100% of that right-of-way. And that's why we have several million dollars in here for right-of-way needs with TxDOT projects. If it's an existing alignment on a TxDOT road and they're widening it, we have to pay for 10% of that right-of-way.
Then we'll get into all of that. You know, we got plenty of time. I just want to make sure that people have the ability to, you know, read the project list and know how you've categorized it in the meantime. Obviously, you know, the next several months you're going to be digging into the things that you're going into. So is everybody kind of comfortable with their ability to read it? We're a couple of minutes past now. Dr. Wallace?
Just one question. Will you be providing a breakdown or doing an overview of the engineer costs, the MAD 2, the MAD 4, as well as the estimated levels, the B through the D? Because I know that's not listed on here, but can some at least probably just be sent out so those of us that may not know what those are, we at least have an understanding?
Yeah, we can definitely get into that a little more detail. You know, as far as, you know, a lot of that information, I don't know if it's too interesting for you or not, but we can definitely, you know, get into detail on those and why we put those in there.
In addition to the fact that we'll have lots of time to talk about that. But with the one thing I do want to make sure is that these are all projects that are eligible for our consideration.
Well,
both
and,
from your
and if
perspective
it's not on the list,
and from finance.
It could still, we you know, this is just what we have. If anyone brings a project to the committee, I mean, nothing's off the list. You know, I mean, you can add anything you want.
And mine is slightly different in that there's nothing on this list that we can't contemplate as one that we would put forward as a recommendation. There's no reason that it's disqualified for our consideration. So this
Correct.
Is each of these we can look at as a potential candidate.
Absolutely.
Now, we're going to evaluate them all, I understand, but these are at least all eligible for our consideration.
These projects are all eligible for
okay.
capital.
Great.
They're capital projects,
Great.
Capital improvements. So, yes, they would be eligible for the voter-approved bond referendum if that's
Perfect.
Where we end up.
Okay.
I do want to just kind of qualify this. Jessica was kind enough to point out, she's absolutely right. This list is just our rough estimates of the project costs. Whenever you do a bond referendum, there's also issuance costs
yep.
associated with that. That is not captured in these numbers.
Yep.
The other thing that is not captured in these numbers is our use of the GECs, the general engineering
yep.
contractors that are assisting staff to do those. That also comes at a cost. And so you can see now whatever your 400 is minus that. Now that's what you're working
yep.
with, right? So just keep that in mind.
And we did last time,
right.
we by the time we got to the point of making our recommendation, that was all part of our consideration. And so that'll get factored in as we move through it.
Right.
Thanks for the work on putting this together. Very useful. So, all right, if there are no other important questions or comments, we'll adjourn our meeting, and I look forward to seeing y'all in a week.
Alrighty.
And, parking pass.